Targeting animations isn't an exact science, but I can tell you that that's wrong. So just a side note, these animations are hilarious. Especially when the guy's got a giant bobble head. As you can see, these animations weren't made for this rig. This rig has a completely different skeletal structure than the Unreal mannequin here. I'm just gonna show you how to do it so you can take your assets, get something placeholder in, and then replace them with real assets in the future. Also, I'm gonna show you how to get the camera looking up and down, because if you remember in the last tutorial, the camera didn't rotate up and down. So starting off, the first thing we need to do today is fix the spring arm. The camera wasn't able to move up and down when we attached this spring arm. This is because the spring arm is now controlling its rotation of the camera, and the camera had a fixed rotation. What we need to do is, underneath the spring arm, just go over to Use Pawn Control Rotation and just tick that and compile and save. It's that simple. Then you have a character who can look around, look up and down. But to get started today, what we're going to do is take some animations from Unreal. These are provided for you. It's a starter package that you can install to your projects. Pretty straightforward. I'll show you how to do it afterwards. So this is Manny. Their skeleton is slightly different to the skeleton we've been using. So this is the Kenney mesh that we've been using. Their mesh has a different skeletal structure than Manny. So how do we end up making this character's animations work for this one? I'll show you. So Unreal has this system for retargeting animation. What you have to do is first create an IK rig, which basically describes the types of bones on the character. So what we do is we right-click animation, IK rig, IK rig. And then we're just gonna call this IK underscore Kenny, because it's from Kenny. What we'll do, we'll open it up and it's gonna be completely empty. So what we need to do is drop down character medium. The way this works is you set up chains of bones and you name them. Then you do the same on the other rig, and then you set up some IK solvers to help it figure out where the hand should move. And like it will move the bones for you to try and conform as much as it can to that animation. So it's sort of procedural animation in a way. It's using one body's IK rig to sort of inform the other body's IK rig, and they try and match as best they can. What we're going to do now is create some new chains of bones. What I normally do is I start from the arms. So what you want to do here is click the left arm, then go down to the hand. So this gets these bones here. Right click, new retarget chain. Most of the time, it's pretty good at generating a name based off of what you've selected. So in this case, left arm, that's perfect. We're going to press add chain. We're going to do the same for right arm down to the hand and add chain. Okay, so we're going to do this with the leg as well. So we're going to grab left leg all the way down to the end of the toes. Right click, new retarget chain, add chain. Do the same on the leg all the way to the end, add chain. And now we're going to go up to the hips. So we're going to grab the hips all the way up to the upper chest. Right click, new chain. Sometimes the name isn't correct, so you want to check every time. So we're going to call this spine, add chain. And we're going to do the same with the neck, so all the way to the head end, new chain. I'll explain what IK goals do in a moment, but for now, let's just get them set up. Let's right-click the head underscore end, which is the end of the head chain, create a new goal. Now we're trying to add a goal for the first time. It's going to ask us what solver we want to use. So for now, let's just stick with full body IK. Let's just press add solver. It's then also going to ask us, now we've created this goal, do we want to assign it to the chain that we've created, head? Yes, we do. So we want to do that on the hand. We want to do it on the right hand. Want to do it on the left leg at the very end of the chain, so the toes underscore end. And we want to do it on the right toes underscore end. We'll notice here that the solver is missing a root bone. So if we click the solver, right click hips control, and then set root bone on selected solver. You'll notice that now that we've set a root for the solver, some of these bones have changed color. This is because they're being driven by one of these IK goals. So there's one last thing we want to do, which is to set the root of the retargeting. In this case, I'm going to choose the hips. So if we right click, set retarget root. So now that's done, let's just press save, and this IK rig is ready to go. What I'm going to do now is do the exact same process for the Unreal mannequin. I've done it here already. So I've retargeted to the pelvis, similar to how we've done it to the hips on the Kenney model. We set up the chains for the spine, the arms,
the head, and the legs. Personally, I've only ever done this with humanoid models. I imagine you could do it with quadrupeds if you had similar-ish sizes. I wouldn't want to go too crazy on this. With humanoids, you can get away with quite a bit of difference. We might run into some issues here because the scale of these two models is quite substantially different, as you can see. The head of this character is somewhat large compared to the mannequin's head.
What we're going to do now is create that mapping between the two. So right click, animation, IK rig, IK retargeter. So what we're going to do is call this IK Unreal to Kenney. Open this up. So the first time you open up this retargeter, it's going to ask us what animations to copy from. Because we've created the two rigs, we're now going to use IK underscore Unreal, which is the mannequin's rig. And then it's going to ask us which one we're going to copy to. In this case, we're copying to Kenny's rig, so we're going to press Kenny. Okay, so as you can see, we've got the two meshes here. They're looking similar, but they're not completely accurate. So what I'm going to do very briefly, just going to drop that down to 0.5. You may also notice it starts in retargeted. So if I just pause this button up here, you'll see what the two rigs look like. One of the things I'm going to do very briefly is just modify this shoulder. Because if you've noticed, the two rigs, they are slightly different poses. So if we just go to edit mode, we've selected the left shoulder. I'm just going to change this X axis to minus 30 degrees. And I'll do the same on the right shoulder to positive 30 degrees. And then I'll just come out of edit mode. Now, if I go back to the retargeter, they're slightly closer to where they should be. Now, if you want to test out any of the animations, on the right-hand side here, under the asset browser, this is all the animations that are using the mannequin's rig that are currently in the project. Just click any one of them. Now that we've got one of the animations playing, you can see how the retargeting is working. By default, the meshes are quite close to one another. So what you want to do is just quickly offset one of the meshes from the other. So now we see they're playing the animations. They look okay. So remember how I mentioned that we might have some issues because of the character's head being significantly different to the base model? In this case, I think it's good enough. We're going to be mostly using these animations for prototyping. We're not going to be using them for anything production ready. So let's just look at the walk cycles. See, in this case, you can see the hands aren't great, but again, it's good enough for a prototype. Let's quickly look at the jogs. Yep, so they look like they're animating correctly. We've got the hips bouncing. Okay, so with these animations, they're looking pretty good. At this point, I think what we should do is start exporting some animations because, like I said, these are placeholder assets. They're not going to be perfect. The idea is that we have some custom artwork made for this character just to really sell that it's this character and not just some generic rig. We're going to grab the jogs because we want all of the jogs. Grab all the jogs. So we're going to shift, left click, all of the jogs, and then head up to this export selected animations button. Okay, so what I normally do here is I put them in a special folder just so I know that they're retargeted. So I'll create a retargeting folder and then I'll put the prefix. In this case, I'm going to call it Kenny underscore RT underscore. So it will prefix the animation name with that. It's a nice signifier. So when I go to the art team and ask them to actually replace these with real assets, they can quickly at a glance see that these are retargeted. So let's hit export. Okay. So here we go, we've got our animations, they're retargeted. This isn't as streamlined as Unity's process where it does real-time remapping. Because it's saving out the assets, it saves on the runtime costs of retargeting on the fly. I don't know if I prefer this way versus the real-time way. There may be a way of doing it real-time. I personally don't use retargeted animations in production-ready games. I tend to use these as placeholders. So this use case is perfectly fine for me. I would recommend using most retargeted animations as placeholders because they're always going to need a little bit of polish. Okay, so now we have these animations, we need to set up the blend space. So go back into our blend underscore movement, just open that up. Now you may notice this looks slightly different to what it looked like in the previous video. So all I've changed here is in the horizontal axis, I've changed it to direction. I've set the minimum and maximum axis value to minus 180 and 180. I've also changed the vertical axis to speed with a maximum value of 1200. So the reason for this is I want to drive the animations based off of a direction instead of a velocity. In the animation blueprint, we can make use of a function that will convert a velocity and a character's rotation into a direction value. This direction value is between minus 180 and 180. So minus 180 being backwards, 180 also being backwards, but minus 90 is left and 90 is right, whereas 0 is forward. So we've modified the blend space so it can go smoothly between all of these. So to do this, I set up 4 points. I'll just go through them with you now. So if I just delete everything we have, So now we're to a blank slate again. One thing I would recommend doing is also ticking this snap to grid on both the vertical and horizontal. It just makes life a little bit easier. So what we're going to do is we're going to grab the idle, drop him at zero on the direction axis and zero on the speed axis. We're going to want to do this four times. So on each of the rotations, jogging left, I want to drag that to minus 90 direction and full speed. Jogging right, I want to drag that to 90 direction and full speed. Jogging forward, I want to drag that to zero direction, full speed. And jogging backwards, I want to drag that to direction 180, full speed, and also at minus 180, full speed. So now, that's the new blend space setup. There's only one thing left to do, and that's to set up the animation blueprint itself. So if we go into the animation blueprint, I'll show you the modifications I've made. The variables, instead of it being vertical and horizontal, I've changed them to direction and speed. You can rename a variable by pressing F2 and typing in whatever you'd like. Instead of splitting up the velocity struct and feeding that into the horizontal and vertical, I now instead take the vector length of velocity. You can do this by pulling off a pin. This will show us all the actions to do with a vector. And in this case, we want length. So we just take vector length. That will return a float value, which we then feed into speed. There's also this calculate directions function. If I drag off velocity and type calculate direction, it will show this function here. This is a helper function that takes in a velocity and then also takes in a base rotation for the character and then spits out a variable between 180 and minus 180, depending on the direction. So if I'm running forward, the output value is going to be zero. If my character is moving backwards relative to the direction I'm facing, value will be 180 or minus 180. We had to add this getActorRotation function here. Again, grabbing the pin off the owner, you have all the actions related to that pawn object. GetActorRotation is one of those. So feed the rotation into the base rotation and set that to the direction. The actual animation graph hasn't changed too much. It was previously feeding in vertical and horizontal. Now it's feeding in direction and speed. You notice how we've changed the axis name. It's updated the name here in the blend space. So let's hit save. Now if we hit play, the character is able to stand in place. We can run left, we can run right with the strafe animations, we can run forward and we can run backwards. So here we have it, retargeted animations from an Unreal rig sent into a new custom rig where the character now moves around using strafing left and right. Thank you for watching. I've been trying to get these videos together in a way that's kind of trying not to expose too much information out the gate because I know how big and scary this engine can be. When I first started in Unreal, there was just a lot of buttons and a lot of code and a lot of widgets that did things. It was pretty overwhelming for me to begin with. If you do have any questions or comments, or if you'd like me to do something different or maybe change the editing style, please let me know. Hopefully the audio is feeling a bit better. I've changed the microphone. I've also been setting things up slightly different in my office, so now I have sheets all over the walls, so it has less echo. The next video, I'm going to start introducing some actual gameplay mechanics. So we're going to have a character with a weapon. That weapon is going to fire shells. Those shells are going to be actors that spawn. They're going to hit characters and they're going to deal damage. I'm going to slowly ease you into what's called the gameplay ability system. This is a rather large system that Unreal has as a plugin that you can add in. It's free. Don't worry, I'm not going to recommend any paid plugins right now, but yeah, it's built into Unreal. It's very powerful. I use it in pretty much every project I've worked on. It's a really robust, powerful system that's really useful for making any sort of gameplay mechanics. So I'm going to slowly ease you into how that works. In coming videos, this is going to turn into a traditional zombie shooter. So zombies are going to spawn and you're going to run away and you're going to pick up health packs and weapons and whatnot from the zombies. And then I'm going to introduce some multiplayer elements so you'll be able to play with other people. I'll be able to introduce you into how networking works within Unreal. But again, I'm going to take it nice and easy. I'm not going to try and introduce too many concepts too quick. But like I said, thank you so much for watching. And hopefully, if this helps, just let me know. Please leave a comment as well. I've been trying to respond to all of them. And one of the things I've really loved is everyone that's coming to these videos is a dev in some way. So they're sharing tips and tricks with each other within the community. It's great. Please keep doing that. It makes my day. So anyway, take care. See you later.